Thank you for tuning in to the Refuge Church YouTube channel. We pray that you're blessed by the message. Let's join the service already in progress.
Let's stand and let's praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untainable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing. You are amazing, God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Oh, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name, you are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Hallelujah.
believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. I believe you rose.
Presence, Lord,
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, there's nothing worth more that could ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come your glory, God is
We've been going through the book of Daniel, and the book of Daniel, I mean, it's such an incredible book, and it could entertain a child with its colorful stories. It is so intriguing to go through and see what actually happened, and from the New Testament, we look back and we think that the Old Testament, we kind of discount it almost, as though that's not something that was for us, it's for another group. And while we're not under the law, and while that law was fulfilled in Christ, we look back, and the one thing that we can understand from Malachi 3:6, he says that God doesn't change. So when we see how God dealt with godly people, how God dealt with things that were going on there, he says he doesn't change. So how he interacts with us may be a little different. Not having the law, we have Christ who fulfilled it. We do know that we can look and see what God interacted with them. And we see that extensively. We got up to chapter 5. And when we did, we noticed that there was a king named Belshazzar. And there was writing on the wall. And the writing was basically, you got weighed. You got tested. God's checked you out and found out you're light. You didn't cut the mustard. And that was it. That was the end of it. That night, he was dispatched. He was finished. So that was the end of Babylon, as we know it as a kingdom. Now, it's very important to see that this character Babylon in our Bibles is a key. It's like a key figure. And we don't give it the proper place in there to understand what was going on. So we want to see that in the different positions that it was in, how important it is and how it affects mankind. We have been instructed by the Holy Spirit to study that book of Daniel, and in doing that, we see how many different facets that Babylon was moving in, and he's going to show us something a little further today. Now, I asked you guys last week to read three passages, six chapters. There was a section that was inside Isaiah 13 and 14. There was a section that was inside Jeremiah 50 and 51. And there was a section inside Revelation, chapter 17 and 18. And those three sets of two give you a pretty rounded description of Babylon, specifically its existence and ultimate end. Now, inside that, we can look and see that even though we saw that king, Belshazzar, His knees were knocking together, and he was dispatched that night, and Darius took over. That's where it converted, that's where it went over to the Persians. We know that that wasn't the end of Babylon. We see some definitions later on where people describe being in Babylon. We know that Peter even wrote one of his letters from Babylon. You can see it in 1 Peter 5:13. So we know that that wasn't the end of Babylon's existence, but the Bible does speak of an end of the physical Babylon. And as you went through those six chapters, you would have seen that it's very detailed, even violent, the end that was born of God's wrath, specifically. In those six chapters, I'll highlight a couple of them, a couple of verses, just so that you can kind of see what we were talking about. Isaiah 13:1, the very first verse of the very first chapter there, it says, "The burden against Babylon, which Isaiah, the son of Amoz, saw." So he starts describing through verse 3 to 18 the events that are clearly occurring during the tribulation period. You can read that, and some of the very phrases are exactly the phrase that is described in the day of the Lord. We see that. So even in Isaiah 13:19, it says, "And Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the beauty of the Chaldeans' pride, will be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah." Now, we saw the ending when Darius took over. We know that there wasn't a casualty, except obviously the king that got wiped out. There were people inside Babylon that for 3 days didn't even know they'd been taken over. When Cyrus went in, he had stopped the water that was flowing through the city, and the men entered into the city through the floodgates because it was only as high as the man's thigh. And they had just gone all throughout the city, didn't even know it. So when the time came, they just said, "Oh, you've already been taken over. We're just letting you know." So there wasn't anything like Sodom and Gomorrah that occurred. Continuing in verse 20, "It will never be inhabited," it says, "nor will it be settled from generation to generation. Nor will the Arabian pitch tents there, nor will the shepherds make their sheepfolds there." So you can kind of see that this is final. When God says something's final, it's final. Jeremiah speaks by the same spirit as Isaiah, and in Jeremiah 50, verse 9, he said, "For behold, I will raise and cause to come up against Babylon an assembly of great nations from the north country, and they shall array themselves against her. From there she will be captured. Their arrows shall be that of those of an expert warrior. None shall return in vain." So we're seeing the same kind of thing that Isaiah was saying. That verse right there particularly is very interesting. You go back to its original language in Hebrew, or you can go to the Septuagint in Greek and read that the expertise of this archer shooting an arrow, the expertise is not in the archer. The expertise is not that this guy is so good firing. The expertise is in the arrow. When you read that verse, you see that the arrows will be like an expert warrior. That's one translation, and will not return empty-handed. Another one says, "Their arrows will be like skilled warriors who do not return empty-handed." So the intelligence here is in the arrow. They can't miss. So what are we looking at? Possibly smart bombs. Something where the intelligence is in the item, not in the, okay? So again, very future. And now we're starting to narrow some things down. He continues in verse 23, Jeremiah 50, 23, "How the hammer of the whole earth has been cut apart and broken. How Babylon has become a desolation among the nations. I have laid a snare for you. You have indeed been trampled, O Babylon, and you were not aware. You have been found and also caught because you have contended against the Lord." The prideful one is going to fall. In verse 32, same chapter, for Jeremiah 50, "The most proud shall stumble and fall, and no one will raise him up. I will kindle a fire in his cities, and it will devour all around him. I will," in verse 44, Jeremiah 51:44, He says, I will punish Bel in Babylon. You remember Bel? Bel was the name that was given to Satan in that kingdom. They always rename this to make it more palatable for whoever's listening. And in this instance, it was Bel. And God says, I will punish Bel in Babylon, and I will bring out of his mouth what he has swallowed. And the nations shall not stream to him anymore. Yes, the wall of Babylon shall fall. My people, go out of the midst of her, and let everyone deliver himself from the fierce anger of the Lord. See, now that sounds very familiar to us, because you read that last section there, and it sounds like what Jeremiah is prophesying is exactly what Jesus was telling John in Revelation. Revelation 18:4 says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues. So we can see from these chapters right here that clearly physical Babylon is utterly destroyed in the future. At one point it even says that even the bricks and the things that are there are not used for anything else. That's it. They're done. So we can see that. And even now, it's not currently a very populated place until Saddam's untimely death. He was actually refurbishing it. He actually had gotten the point to where he had archaeologists find the very room that the handwriting was on the wall. And he restored it. He refurbished it. He even had a couple of ceremonies there. So this was in the process of being rebuilt. I've even heard, not extremely recently, but a few years ago, we were hearing that the United Nations was talking about relocating. And they were talking about relocating from New York to Babylon. Because it's more, they were saying that it was more of a centralized, you know, to be where the most of the problems are that they deal with, according to their thinking. So we can keep our antennas up concerning the things that are going on in Iraq. Now, those six chapters, we also can see that Babylon is being referred to in a spiritual sense. See, Revelation 18:3 said, for all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. And the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. Now you see that verse in context. Lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. Jeremiah 51:7, leaning in that same vein, says, Babylon was a golden cup in the Lord's hand that made all the earth drunk. The nations drank her wine. Therefore, the nations are deranged. See, when we look through those chapters, and we're looking at the way that Babylon is being described, we get the physical side, but we miss that the spiritual side is something that was critical. And even more important, critically for us today, in Isaiah, same set of chapters, 13 and 14, I want to go to 14, and I want to read a passage that we have looked at many times. And a lot of times we're looking at this. There's two chapters in the Bible that talk about the preexistence of Satan. It understands where did he come from and what happened. One of them is Ezekiel 28. You can look at that and see that it talks about him before. The other one is Isaiah 14. Happens to be one of the chapters that we were reading. So when I look at this, it goes from verse 3 to verse 17. I'm just going to read it. It's not going to be on the wall. But I want you to listen and try to get an idea of what we're talking about here. Isaiah 14, and then start in chapter 3. And it says, and it shall come to pass, in the day the Lord gives you rest from your sorrow and from your fear and the hard bondage in which you were made to serve, that you will take up this proverb against the king of Babylon and say. So notice that it's talking to the king of Babylon. Okay? How the oppressor has ceased, The golden city ceased. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked, the scepter of the rulers, he who struck the people in wrath with a continual stroke. He who ruled the nations in anger is persecuted, and no one hinders. The whole earth is at rest and quiet. They break forth into singing. Indeed, the cypress trees rejoice over you, and the cedars of Lebanon, saying, since you were cut down, no woodsman has come against us. Verse 9, hell from beneath is excited about you to meet you at your coming. It stirs up the dead for you, all the chief ones of the earth. It has raised up from their thrones all the kings of the nations, and they all shall speak and say to you, have you also become as weak as we? Have you become like us? Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, and the sound of your stringed instruments. The maggot is spread under you, and the worms cover you. Now that is leading up to something you've probably read before. Verse 12. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of congregation, on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. And those who see you will gaze at you and consider you, saying, is this the man who made the earth to tremble, who shook kingdoms, who made the world as a wilderness and destroyed its cities, who did not open the house of his prisoners? See, we read that section and we know that it was talking about Babylon specifically, but it, as we went through the verse, you saw that it was connected to Lucifer. It was connected to Satan. That verse is very specific. The reference is to Babylon, but indirectly to Lucifer, you know, Satan. So when we look at this and we see that now it's a little bigger picture. We're not talking about Babylon, a city that's in the south of Iraq. We're talking about something that is a spiritual entity. It is a very spirit that we're talking about. And where does it begin? With Lucifer. We see this. Now, there's a comparison here. When you think about, spiritually speaking, Babylon, and you think about Israel, these two are depicted as females. They have a personality to them. They also have certain characteristics, where Jerusalem is the city of God. We see that Babylon is the city of man or rebellion. In actual, you could see that it would be the city of Satan, the birth of rebellion. Jerusalem is the very source of healing and righteousness and light. All forms of occultic activity have their origin in Babylon. Very clearly, we can trace any one of the occultic things that you see today. Its birthplace was definitely Babylon. The Savior of all of mankind is from Jerusalem. We see that the first anti-god, Nimrod, was Babylon. We see that through Zechariah and some other prophets, that the last Antichrist will be also from that heritage. He'll be an Assyrian. This represents, Jerusalem represents God, order, peace, where Babylon represents Satan, chaos, and rebellion. So we get that. We can see that this is not just an evil city. You can't say, well, Babylon, it's like Vegas, or it's like, you know, pick a city that's known for something dark. It's not just like that. It's far beyond that. This is something spiritual. Now let's take a closer look here at what we know about Babylon and what we should know about Babylon. Babylon was established by Nimrod. Nimrod was an Assyrian. by birth. He was the grandson of Noah. He was about 200 years before Abraham. And his name, Nimrod, means to rebel. Doesn't it sound already like he's following in Satan's footsteps? The rebel. Nimrod came from Noah's son, Ham. And Ham already had some sons that were being cursed. So we can see that this line is already something that's heading off into something that wasn't godly, like Seth's. Genesis 10, many of our Bibles say he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Genesis 10:8, I believe. So when in reality, Nimrod rebelled in the face of the Lord. There is a translation, I know the man, his name is Welty, William Welty, and he worked on a translation recently because so many of these translations are birthed out of a bad source code that he said we need to get a translation of something that's actually accurate. And it's in a modern language, but the reason for doing it was accuracy, not language. And it's called the ISV. I don't use it because he still leans on some things in the New Testament from a bad source code. So I still stick with the New King James and explain as we go. But in the ISV for the Old Testament, he got a renowned expert in Isaiah. And or Old Testament and Genesis. And as he did this, he started to break down what it means. The ISV translation in Genesis 10:8 says, Cush fathered Nimrod, who became the first fearless leader throughout the land. He became a fearless hunter in defiance of the Lord. This is why it is said, like Nimrod, a fearless hunter in defiance of the Lord. So we know now, this is not a guy that's like, man, this is a great guy for God. No, he's not. This is a completely in rebellion. So the first world dictator, the first anti-God leader. Another thing that we'll find is that the Nephilim from Genesis 6, the offspring of the angel-human hybrids, we see that they're listed as the mighty ones. That's one of the names they were given. Well, it also says in Genesis, talking about Nimrod, it says that he became to be a mighty one on the earth. So we know that his knowledge and his abilities were all from his connection and worship directly of Satan, of everything that is dark, to try to be equal with God. Nimrod building that Tower of Babel was an attempt to raise himself and Satan to be equal with God, trying to fulfill what was said in Isaiah 14. He was trying to extend this. He's worshiping Satan and trying to accomplish the exact same thing. So it's unmistakable where Nimrod is coming from. The spirit that was over Nimrod did not die with him. It didn't die when he was, just like Babylon, the physical, went down, it was defeated. That spirit that was with Nimrod continued on. Remember Nebuchadnezzar's golden statue. He said, worship that statue or I'm going to kill you. See, this thing continued. That spirit continued. And if you notice, there are areas around the world that have a spirit that kind of lords over them. We see certain things that lord over Vegas. We see certain things that lord over San Francisco or Key West. We see these kinds of things around. We even see where Daniel, later on in the book, he talks about how the angel said, when I return, I have to fight the prince of Persia. I have to fight the prince of Greece. There are certain spirits that are over this, that lord over this. This spirit that was lording over Babylon is what continued on. See, as the spirit of Babylon continued to move through the time, we see it kind of diversify into the many various worship of Satan. We see this thing. We go back in the Old Testament and we see that there was a prophet. And he was against 900 other anti-God prophets. They were worshiping Baal. And so he said, do whatever you want to do. Go ahead, soak my sacrifice, whichever one is consumed. And we all know how it ended. Jehovah God outdid whatever they were supposed to do. He even got funny. He even said, hey, maybe your God's asleep. Maybe you should scream louder. He said, maybe he had to go tinkle. Wait till he comes back from the bathroom. And they were cutting themselves, and then when our God came on the scene, poof, he burned the sacrifice, he burned the altar, he burned the dirt, he burned everything that was there. There was nothing left. So we see that kind of thing where it's black and white. It's head to head. Somebody says, oh, well, I'm following Baal, and you say, I'm following Jehovah. It's black and white. Where the transition was the cross. What happened was when we got to the cross, no longer did he start to confront us head to head. What he said was, I'm going to melt in. I'm going to start diversifying. I'm going to start coming up with other ways to get to these people that's not as black and white. It would be much harder for somebody to walk over to a believer and say, hey, why don't you start worshiping Baal? No. But if other watered-down things started to surface, now you got a foothold. Now you got a way to get in. So regardless of the vehicle that is used by the spirit of Babylon, the end goal is always to turn the worship from Jehovah God, Elohim. It is to turn from that and replace with the worship of Satan. Get him to stop worshiping, focusing, lifting up the King of Kings, the God of creation. Get them to start looking at something else. That's what the ultimate goal is. Now, we know that Rome merged the early church, the persecuted church, the ones that were being burned at the stake and being fed to lions, they merged with all of this occultic activity from Babylon. And they merged it together so that, well, why can't we all just get along? And so they said, well, this temple of Zeus, we can use this as a gathering point. They even had one leader that says, I saw something in the sky. It was a cross. I'm a believer. So all of a sudden, here we go. We're all going over there. And next thing you know, we're celebrating things on the 25th of December. We're celebrating things. All of a sudden, we're kind of melted these two things together. You know. And when they came up with this, they came up with something where they called it the Roman Catholic Church. Catholic meaning universal. It's all good. Come all together here. The interesting thing about this is it's not just history. This is not just something that we look back and go, oh my gosh, that's just so old, everything's different now. The truth of the matter is that the Pope met with Abbas, the leader of the Palestinian organization, yesterday. Israel was not invited. They got up and they sang a song in Arabic by an Islamic girl singing this song, and the song sang the words that Jesus is not God, Muhammad is his prophet, in Catholic Church. So we can see that this universal thing, the spirit of Babylon, has not ended. We have to understand that the spirit of Babylon is something that the sons of God today, it's alive and well. And this is our opposition. If our battle is not with flesh and blood, if our battle is the principalities and powers of the air, this is the battle. The battle is the spirit of Babylon. It has not ended, because it's not something that just ended with Babylon. This is something that starts with Lucifer. I will ascend. I will. I'm taking all this away from God. I'm going to do this. And it just keeps going all the way through history until we've arrived at this time. And the things that we are seeing occur around us today are outstanding. They're incredible. They are the very fulfillment of prophecy from thousands and thousands of years ago. And yet we look at this, and I don't even think some of us realize. Do you know God could have put you at any point in time on the timeline? You could have been with Sir Walter Raleigh. You could have been with Columbus. You could have been with Paul. You could have been in the Dark Ages, somewhere in Europe. You could have been anywhere along that timeline. But you know what he did? He put you right here. He put you right here and right now. And you know what that says? I know your abilities. I know that the battle is going to get the hottest at the end, and you are the one that I need right there. And we have got to understand that that is a calling from somebody who knows us better than we know ourselves. That we are somebody that says, if God thinks I can do it, I need to get off my butt and get going. I got stuff we got to do. I need to get serious about this. I need to understand what we're talking about. The continuing on with this, that December the 23rd, the president that'll be gone in a few more days decided to turn on Israel one last time. I say one last time. Let's hope it was one last time. There was a vote in the United Nations that said that what we're going to do is we're going to take all the land where Israel is and we're going to call it occupied because they're occupying the Palestinians' land. And this vote is not new. They've been trying to vote this for years. But the difference was every single time America stood up and said no. America stood up and says, whoever blesses Israel, I will bless. And whoever curses Israel, I will curse. And I will not be cursed by God. Well, this time, he abstained. He did not vote for it, but he knew that the way that the votes were stacked, by removing his vote, it would pass. And it did. So as of the 23rd of December, Israel is in occupied land, according to the United Nations. So that continued on a peace meeting that is occurring in Paris right now. There are 70 nations. How many? Not a strange coincidence. There are 70 nations that are gathered to talk about peace between the Palestinians and Israel. Do you know that everybody's invited except one? Israel. And I think that's a little like having a wedding without a groom. So they are deciding on what is going to be there. And what they are pushing for is to go to a set of borders that makes Israel 9 miles wide. Now, I don't know about you, but even with all of the technology that we've got, it'd be hard enough to defend Israel when I can fly across it in a jet in minutes. 9 miles wide? You could almost have some of our drive-by shootings hurt them from the other side of the border. So this is going to put them in a very precarious situation. Physical, right? We're seeing in the physical. What is it in the spiritual? Babylon. Babylon is pushing the envelope. What are we seeing the lineup for? Psalm 83. What are we seeing the lineup for? Ezekiel 38 and 39. What do we understand as sons of God? That the battle is in the spirit. It's not in the flesh. What do we know for a fact? That anytime somebody comes against Israel, they walk away limping and hurt. Anytime somebody comes against Israel, I don't care if they're a giant, they lose their head. And this has been that way since the very beginning. They may have got taken into Babylon because they were in disobedience, but they walked out of Babylon exactly 70 years later because the time of the disobedience had been chastised and completed. And what happened? They were sent home with money to rebuild. So anytime somebody comes against Israel, something gets hurt. And it may be a coincidence. I'm just going to throw this out there. It's conjecture on my part. But it seems like every time we do something against God or against Israel, something happens to us. I've been following a timeline where it seems like every time we step out of line and do something against Israel, we got a storm, a flood, an earthquake, a hurricane. Something happens somehow or another. And I think, people, please pray for our leaders. I don't care if you don't like them because of some other situation that they did. If you've got one that says we're going to back Israel, get on board. Because I am much more worried about the spiritual battle than any kind of personal thing I may not like. The spiritual battle that we are dealing with right now is no joke, and it's permanent. So when we look at this, it's not limited to that. It's a good against evil. So this spirit of Babylon, now convincing somebody that just being good is enough, that's all they need to do, well, that is fulfilling the goal. It achieves the goal. See, if I could convince people that all you really got to do is show up to church and give a certain amount of money and make sure you bring your Bible, and you know, and be real pious when you show up, well, there you go. All the checklist is done, and you're going to be in heaven. Isn't that great? What I've done is I've accomplished the goal because I've taken it away from being focused on Jehovah, the very relationship that says you and I are one. It's a belief. It's a trust. It's an absolute oneness I've got with the King. And then all of a sudden, I've turned it into a list of to-dos. But Lord, didn't I do these things in your name? And he's going to say, I never knew you. I never knew you. But if I can get somebody convinced to follow these religious requirements, I've accomplished the goal of Babylon. That spirit of Babylon has got it where I've got away from walking in a genuine walk with the king. Convincing people that men and women are the same and they're interchangeable. See, you're thinking, well, you know, the Bible doesn't really talk a lot about that. It actually does. Because what you're doing is you're legitimizing homosexuality and all the other deviant sexual behaviors. You're legitimizing them. And you're achieving Satan's goal by replacing God's orderly plan of creation. So you may not think it's a biblical thing, but when in reality, what they're changing is God's order. When God said it is good, he meant that. It is correct. Everything will produce after its own kind. It was designed. It was specific. And then Satan says, I'm going to raise my throne. So what does he do? Let's thwart everything that God did. Everything that is coming out of what we see today, oh, well, we need to love. The Bible does say love. What they've done is they've changed the very definition. Love does not mean in agreement. You may have somebody that is under that homosexual spirit, that deviant sexual spirit. You know what you do? You love them. You love them no matter what. You don't cause that, you don't treat them any different. You don't act any different towards them. You share the love of God with them. And when the subject comes up, you tell them, we do not agree. I am in agreement with the Bible. But that does not change the fact that I love you. Love is not an emotion. Love is not a feeling. Love is not agreement. Love is something that we choose to do. You don't fall in love. You don't fall out of love. Love is a choice. So when we run into these people, they want to say, oh, you're mean and hateful and intolerant because you don't love them. No, not true. Love them no matter what. Love them the way God loves. God loved the world. Does that mean he's in agreement with a sin? Certainly not. But he loved them so much that what did he do? He died for them. So when we see this Babylon spirit with its fingers reaching out to us, we have to fight. How? Spiritually. How do we fight? Love. Love. Love is the one thing that the enemy cannot come against. You stand up and say, well, I know some scriptures that's going to put that guy in the dust. And you start quoting scriptures because you're so smart. Well, then there's going to be somebody else that can quote other things just as smart, and you're going to look like an idiot. Why? Because you've leaned on your own understanding. We need to not lean on our own understanding. We need to lean on him. And when we love, how can they come against that? They can't. It's not possible. When Jesus went before all of those illegal trials and they said, aren't you going to say anything? Don't need to. There is not one thing that I'm going to do to stop me from getting to that cross. And when he got there, what did he say? Lord, forgive them. He loved them to death. And that is what we do when we're fighting this spirit of Babylon. See, the spirit of Babylon places value on wealth and power and status in this kingdom of darkness here. See, the God of this world is over this kingdom of darkness that we're in. And they place value on those things. This is why they tried to reward the godly people that we read about in Daniel with a gold chain, a purple robe, a certain position inside the kingdom. See, it's the wealth and the power and the status. See, this is exactly why 1 John 2:16 tells us that for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it's of the world. It's of the kingdom of Babylon. It's of everything that Babylon's trying to get. Because if he can get us chasing those things, he can lead us around like a bull with a ring in his nose. Because once we're hooked on those things and those are what we're chasing, suddenly he's got exactly what he wanted. We've taken our eyes off of God and put them onto something else. And then we can get led around by emotions all over the place. Your day will be completely controlled by how you feel. You wake up and you go, man, I just don't feel like today. Well, we don't go off of feelings. See, we don't walk around off of feelings. We go off of what we know. See, we may wake up, and there's a spirit of depression that is trying to get on us. And it's hovering, and it's lurking around us. What did he say to a couple of the guys in the Old Testament? Oh, you don't know that sin is sitting at the door waiting. And they're just waiting to jump on us. And what we do is we stand up when we say, Lord, thank you for breath for my lungs. Thank you for my home being in heaven. Thank you for me being one with you. I am the son of a king, and I will walk it out. And I will walk through this as a son of the king, walking through the kingdom. And depression, you got no right. You need to move. You need to get on. You need to get out of here. And we walk it out. See, this is how the spirit of Babylon tries to continue, because he's trying to weaken the people. Remember what it said in Isaiah. Is this the man who weakened nations? How did he weaken them? In the New Testament, I haven't found an instance yet where Satan walked over and forced someone to do something. It doesn't work. What does he do? Works on the mind. See? That's the thing. That's the thing where he's starting to reach in and tweak on us by our thought process. See, when we look at this, the strategy of the spirit of Babylon in the book of Daniel, see, let's take a look and see what was happening in the beginning of all this. He was trying to get God's people to conform to the way of Babylon. And it may even seem insignificant. What was the first thing? He gathered up those boys, those Hebrew boys. He gathered them up, and they said, here is the king's food. And the boys, they said, no, thank you. We will be okay if we get vegetables. We've boiled it down to it was something similar to beans. High protein, fiber. So these guys are going to get fed. And water. And then they said, test us. 10 days. 10, the number of testing. And they said, test us and see. So when we look at this and we see that, well, it was just food. You know, what's a big deal? What Babylon was trying to do was to get them to take something into the body. They were trying to get them to change what they would do and start taking something foreign into the body. How do we do that? What are you watching on TV? Sometimes I'm a little dated because I'll say TV or radio. How about this? What are you watching on YouTube? What are you watching on the internet? There's plenty of things on the internet. You don't even got to go to the TV. I know some people that got rid of a TV, but the evilness of the computer far surpassed what they were watching on TV. What are you watching? What are you taking in? See, the idea behind food is that you take the food and you ingest it. And what does it do? It breaks down and becomes one with your body. You ever heard the phrase, you are what you eat? There is no coincidence that the Lord tells us to gather in his name and have communion. And what did he say? This is my body. It was a single piece. And what did he do with it? He broke the single piece, and everybody got a piece. He took a piece. What happened with that? After they ate it, it became one with them. So what is it that linked all those people together? She ate it, he ate it, and I ate it. It became one with us because we ate it and we metabolized it into our body, right? So what was it? The Lord's body. That is significant to be able to see. We're all one with the Lord. He's trying to get you to understand that you are one. And the stuff that you take into your body, you become one with. Paul said, should we become one with a harlot? Because you become one. These are the things that are what we would be dealing with, where they would say, no, thank you on the food. Even substances like marijuana. I know that's a heavy thing right now. And a lot of people that I know say, well, it's legal. It is legal according to man's law. So's abortion. And in most places, so is homosexual marriage. So do we approve it just because man did? No, we do not. We follow God's law. God's law supersedes everything else. And what did Daniel say? No, thank you. I'm not going to do this. And when you stand for God, he stands for you. When you stand for God, he has your back, no matter what. And at the end of that, The guy that was in charge of them, as well as the king himself, said, man, these guys are 10 times better than all the rest of them. Thank you, Lord. You start turning this kind of stuff off and not taking it in one, you will walk away from this with the world looking at you going, wow, that one is way better than everything else. And what is it? It's the Lord. It's God walking with us. See, it's just a seemingly insignificant act that we run into, right? In chapter 2. So we see, well, there's a statue. You know, just a little bow to the statue. You know, when you hear the music, you know, just a little bow. Not really much different than what they did in Rome. We had Polycarp. The dude was over 100. And here he is. They sought him out and found him. They went and tried to find this guy. Powerful spiritual pastor of Ephesus. And they sought him out and they brought him. Look, Polycarp, look, this ain't a big deal, dude. All you got to do is just take a pinch of this and just put it in the fire, you know? You're just saying Caesar is God. It's not going to be a big deal. You can go on with preaching whatever you're going to preach. And he said, I will not. He said, how could I do this thing against my God that has taken care of me for 87 years? How can I do this? I will not. And he went through that. See, this is what we've got to look at when there are things that are going on when you can compromise. You're at work or you're wherever you're at and there's people around and they start bringing up a discussion that's not godly. They start running down the Bible. They start running down believers somehow. The jokes are endless. And you don't necessarily stand up and say, hey, that's not funny. But yet what you do is you just kind of close up. Maybe a little ha 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 and walk away so that you're not stared at. Well, think about it. When we see these things that are happening, they could have easily just went, you know, it's not really going to hurt. God understands. He wouldn't want me killed over this. You know what God understands? His loyalty. God understands absolute 100% obedience. He knows that if you were willing to walk to the fire for him, that he is willing to take care of you. Remember what they told him? O king, we have no need to answer you in this. Our God is well able to keep us safe from that furnace. But you know what? Even if he's not, we ain't doing it. Because we ain't backing down. We will not bow. And he walks us through it. See, the Babylon is after your prayer life. Because if our battle is not with flesh and blood, it doesn't matter how many AR-15s you've got. It doesn't matter how much ammo you have. What matters is any weapon that would be effectual in a spiritual realm. Well, what is effective in the spiritual realm? Prayer. See, those guys walked in that had seen Paul cast out some demons. And they said, huh, look at this. And they hear him say, in the name of Jesus. So they go, well, how about this, brothers? Our dad, Sceva, you know. So let's go over here. So they went over there. There was a man that had a demon. So they walk in and they go, we got this. So they walk in and they go, you over there, demon guy. We cast you out in the name of Jesus that Paul preaches. And that guy looked up and he said, Paul, I know. And Jesus, I know. Who are you? And ripped them to shreds. The point is not wearing the costume. The point is not wearing a uniform. It's not putting a fish on you or a cross or whatever. The point is who you are known by in those spiritual realms. When the enemy comes and knocks on your door, because it is that spirit of Babylon that's trying to get you to bow. It's trying to get you to stop praying. It's trying to get you to do that. It's that enemy that comes over there, and when you stand up and you say, in the name of Jesus, and he knows that you know who you are a son of the Most High God. And he looks over, and when you say, you are bound. I will not allow this. And what I will allow is the Spirit of God moving in me, in this situation. I loose that. That's when it occurs. That's when stuff happens. So we can't play church anymore. We have to get serious about this. We have to walk this out, and we have to know that that spirit of Babylon, it ain't gone. It, if anything, it's increased. There was a point that was made this morning in prayer. Out of all the prophecies that had been made about Jesus on his first earth walk here, over half of them had been fulfilled before he was dead. What that means is, the day that he was crucified, over half of them were fulfilled in one day. What that means is, you see this slow increase of things that are happening, and the closer it gets to the end, the closer it starts increasing, the more it starts increasing. What did he tell us about it being like the childbirth? It'll be like the birth pangs of a woman, it says. What happens? They get more intense and closer together. More intense and closer together. It's not this slow climb. I've heard people say, oh, they've been saying that forever. I was talking to my wife this morning, and I said, it is absolutely amazing to see that Israel is this big. And all of these people that are against Israel are this big. And yet the entire world is willing to ostracize them, to put sanctions on them, to try to hurt them, to try to harm them in whatever facet. And you can't see this, even in the natural. If there was a bully on a school ground that was this big and he's beating up on a kid this big, somebody would go over there and help the kid. Even if they didn't know the situation, they would go, hang on a second. But they don't, because it's not physical. It's spiritual. This is good and evil. This is God fighting Satan. This is him saying, go ahead, try. It's not a battle. When we look at it like a battle, it's as if Satan actually has power. He doesn't. He has none. The battle that we go through, when it says the renewing of the mind for us in the believer, it's for us to battle our mind. That's why it's a mind field. Because inside that battle, we start to understand who we are. How many of us have gone to church for years? I mean years. And it's just now that you're being taught and you're hearing, do you know who you are? So many times we've been taught that we're at the cross. Oh, Lord, thank you. Oh, Lord, I'm just a sinner. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And for that long time, you were always placed on this side of the cross. And it's like you don't realize that the Holy Spirit reached out and grabbed you and pulled you through the cross. You're on this side. You're not on that side. You're not a sinner saved by grace. You're a brand new creation that never existed before. And this one on this side, those sins that the enemy keeps reminding you of, they're gone. So what do we do on this side? We're supposed to start looking and saying, who am I? You are a son. Those guys in the New Testament, when you read they were raising the dead, when you read that they were healing the sick, they knew who they were. They were walking out who they were. They would look over at stuff, and they wouldn't see it as, oh, this dead guy, I wonder if he's going to get up if I pray for him. They were looking at it very clearly in the spiritual. That is demonic. In Jesus' name, life, enter back into that guy. And people go, oh, well, isn't that, you know, that's boisterous. You know, you're, what are you talking about? He gave us the power to become the sons of God. All through Scripture, it's telling you this. And you never take the credit. You never say, look at me. You say, I am one with him. I can only walk this out because of what he did on the cross. I can only walk this out because he defeated the enemy, made a show of them openly. So what are we doing? We're walking this out. So what are we doing today? We're looking to see that that spirit of Babylon that is trying to encroach, we don't look at it anymore as a, oh my gosh, dig a hole, get in the bunker, cover up. There's no more trench warfare. Trench warfare has got to stop. It says that this is my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Gates. Are they a defensive or offensive weapon? Defensive. The gates of hell. Who's attacking who? I don't see a set of gates chasing down believers. I see believers kicking in gates. And if that gate of hell is not going to prevail against us, that means we know who we are. And we walk over those gates and we go, no, done. And we walk this out. And I'm telling you that the stuff that you are going to see coming up very soon is going to prove this out. This is something that we have got to understand is live and in person. I know that you've heard, oh, we're in the last days. I heard it. I said it. It was back in the 80s. Oh, we're living in the last days, you know, because I saw things that were happening. And they were happening. But the birth pangs were not increasing to where we are now. And when we see this, it's not time to bury your head. It's not time to, oh, woe is me. It's time to go, that's it. That's enough. I've had it. And where does it start? Amen. It starts right there. Where does it start? In your family. Beverly says, hey, family, let's go to church. Family says, done in the name of Jesus. That is what we need to do. Because what we are walking out is truth. See, there is going to be a move that is going to happen so quick. The two things that are the prongs that they are using to come against us the quickest are the homosexuality stuff and Islam. And you are seeing the church swallow this stuff hook, line, and sinker. And what do they say? Well, we have to love them. Huh? Wrong definition. Love? Yes. So would you have a homosexual come to your church? Would I have a sick person go to the hospital? Of course they need to be here. And when they're here, what do? We're going to love on them. And what do? We're going to pray for them. And what do? We're going to tell them the truth. So we love them, absolutely, but we do not compromise. And that is what is happening. And what you're going to see happen is this is going to happen so quick and so fast that there's going to be believers that are going to be kicked off and not understand, and suddenly they're going to be saying, well, I don't know if the Bible really says that about homosexuals, the gay people. Well, I really don't know if it says that about Islam. I really don't, you know. And you're standing there looking at this going, oh, my. The way I saw it this morning, as if you're playing a Monopoly game with somebody. And even though you're playing a Monopoly game, you're explaining to this person, you realize this is just a game, right? And the person looks at you and they swear up and down that they live on Boardwalk. And they, I got to get going. I know we're talking, but I got to go past Go to get my $200 because I got to ride on the Reading Railroad. You know what I'm saying? They are so engulfed in this game that they actually think they're in the game. You're playing the game, but you're on the outside looking at the pieces and you go, that's not reality. This is what we are looking at as far as the spiritual realm is concerned. We know that's not reality. That is the spirit of Babylon. And we are looking at it going, reality is the King of Kings. That Bible right there is the only thing that we can hang on to that is absolute truth. I don't care what rational, emotional explanation you try to come up with, the Bible does not say that. Amen? So it's a time for the church, for us as believers. We are the church. The church is not an entity. We are raising up and knowing who we are. Amen? We need to know what that means. So
thank you for tuning in to the Refuge Church YouTube channel. We pray that you received a word that brings peace to your soul and joy to your heart. In these days that we are living in, chaos is increasing, and it's important to have our hope in the one who brings order, Jesus Christ. Refuge Church is a group of believers who have their hope in God, His Word, and His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We believe that growth occurs in small groups. If you're looking to fellowship with a group like this, you are welcome to join us at Refuge. We are located at 24711 Redlands Boulevard, Suite K in Loma Linda, California, 92354. Our men's Bible study meets on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Our women's Bible study meets on Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. We meet for praise and worship every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. If this message has blessed you and you'd like to link shields with us and support this ministry financially to help continue the work that we do for the kingdom, you can log on to our website at www.refuge-church.com and click the giving button. To access more teaching from the Refuge, log on to our website and click on the audio and video button. These will give you the links to our YouTube channel and to our podcast. We'd be glad if you joined us. Thanks again. And we pray that the Lord blesses you and keeps you as you grow in His Word.